Hello and welcome everybody. This is section 7 of the notes, and here we are going to discuss the k nearest neighbor estimator. And this section is a bit shorter, and my suggestion would be to jump straight in and see what that estimator is all about. So let's have a look. So the k nearest neighbor estimator is a method for smoothing, and I want to explain that with the help of a simple example. So let's assume we are given these data points. So for each of them, we have an x value and then corresponding y values. And the k nearest neighbor estimate is conceptually rather simple. Namely, what it does is, if we want to compute the estimate for a new point x, what we do is we find the k nearest neighbors in input space. So say k is 3. Then we would find the 3 nearest points, which I think is this one and that one and that one. Then we look at the corresponding y values and we average these. So there are 2 of the upper values, 1 of the lower values, so the average may be about here. And then that's our estimate for the mean line at the point x. So this one here we'd call m hat of x, and since it depends on the number of points we used, I call it m hat k of x. Good. Let me first write it what we are doing. M hat k of x is, I'll write it in words here, average of the y values or the k nearest samples. So that is in words what the k nearest neighbor estimator is. And in the notes, I wrote that as a formula, which makes it look more mathematical, but admittedly, nothing much is gained by that way of writing it, so we can just as well use that one, and I'm not going to explain the formula here. So instead, I want to look at what happens to this estimator if we change x a bit. And the first thing is clear: if we go to the right, that value will not change, because the nearest 3 points, if you're further to the right, will always be these 3 points, this one, that one, and that one, which I've just marked here. So the only interesting thing which will happen close to x is if we go to the left, and there will be a point where suddenly this point is closer to x than that one. Let's just put some markers. If we have x3 and x6, so in the middle between the two, around here, it will happen that suddenly x3 is closer than x6. So let's just assume that's a bit to the left of x5. So up to this point, the 3 nearest neighbors are that, that, and that. And the average is always the same. It's the average of the corresponding y values. Then at this point, we jump. Namely, this one is now out, and that one suddenly gets included. And the new value is a bit lower than the thrown out value, so the average will go down a bit. It may look like this. And now if you continue going left, you can see what happens. For a while, this and this point are the closest neighbors, and this lower value will continue to the left. Now the question is, where does the value change again? There will be another jump at the point where suddenly this point is closer to x than that one. Then this will be thrown out and that will be added into the average. But we just need to find the middle again. Let's say the middle maybe here. And at this point, the value will now be quite a bit lower, because now we are averaging this, that, and that y value. So there are 2 values low and we may be somewhere here. We jump to here and you see how that goes. So we get a piecewise continuous function, which jumps whenever a new point comes into range and an old one goes out. And then at the end, I lost track of how many jumps there still need to be. Ah, there's one more jump. So that may happen here. And then it will be constant forever, because then it will always be x1, x2, and x3, which are the closest points. So this red curve would be the k nearest neighbor regression line for k equals 3. Good, and there are only a small number of things to know about that regression line. Namely, the first thing is, k now controls the smoothing. So if k is small, then we are more susceptible to fluctuation in the points because fewer points are averaged. And if k is large, then more points are averaged. The line becomes more stable, but also it sees what happens farther away, so it cannot pick up smaller peaks. That is very similar to what we had before. And the new thing here is that the bandwidth, the range of points we average, depends on how dense the data is. So let me draw a different example. So if we assume the data comes in two groups like this, with a gap in the middle, then our kernel regression here in the middle, these methods may be struggling a bit. And the k-nearest neighbor method, that addresses this a bit by just widening the window. So if you think if x is here, let's just do four nearest points for simplicity, maybe it's these four, then we average a range as large as that, and that is because there are few points in the vicinity, so that would be for k equals 4. And in contrast, if we look at that x, then we have 4 points close by, so then the range where we average over would be much smaller, it would be only that range. So in a sense, that is adaptive bandwidth selection. Namely, where there are more points, we average over smaller intervals. Where there are fewer points, we average over larger intervals because we need more space until we have collected our k points. And that is really all there is to it. There are some more details in the notes, but it's a short section. There's not very much. And instead of talking about this, I want to just show you a bit how that is done in R. So I want to use the old faithful data set, this one here, which we have already seen in previous examples. And that has two columns, namely length of eruptions and waiting time until the next eruption. And if I remember right, we used earlier that as the input and that as the output. So let's call these x and y just to make it a bit easier to tell them apart. Then the data we have already seen, so if we do plot x against y, it looks like that. Let's have a bit smaller margins here. That looks better. And now we want to fit a regression line to that using k nearest neighbor regression. So the package I want to use is called FNN, which stands for fast nearest neighbor. And that provides a function knn.reg, here's the manual, which can be used for k nearest neighbor regression. They also provide classification using the k-nearest neighbor methods, and I think that's what they call knn. Yes, so the name knn is for their classification routine, but we are doing regression here, so we are using that one. Good, now we need to understand how that is done. So train is a matrix or data frame of training set cases, and here y, it says, is the response of each observation in the training set. So I assume we plug in the x here and the y here. Let's try that. So train is x and y equals y. That did something. So let's call that m. And now I would like to add this to the plot. So we need to understand what does m do. The returned object is a list containing at least the following components. I just wonder whether we did this right. It said matrix or data frame. I think let's actually, because our x is a vector, let's actually convert that to be sure. That looks the same. I don't think we changed anything. Okay, so here in the output, I think that's what we need, a vector of predicted values. So predicted gives us numbers, and I assume they probably go with the x values. So let's do lines x m dollar pred. Okay, so I think the conclusion is the points in the data set are not ordered, so I connected them in random order. Let's just rerun that thing and just draw points. Good, so I think, looking here in the middle, that probably what we get here are the fitted values. So there is a big black circle which comes from here, which is one of our data points, and then just underneath is a little red circle which comes from that points command. So I think what this does is it just gives us the KNN estimate at the points where we have data. So I want to draw a smooth line. So what we need to do is we need to use the test argument. We just tell it where do we want to evaluate the k nearest neighbor estimate. So let's do that. So x, let's call it test like they do. Ranges are from 1.5 to 5 maybe. And I don't know, let's go in steps of 0.01. That's 351 values. That seems reasonable. And then here I tell it test is x test. And I think here we actually need to make it a data frame. Let's try that. Good. And then here we need to do x test, I assume. Yes. And now we can go back to lines and all will be well. Good. So I believe that is our k nearest neighbor estimate. And that fluctuates quite a bit, which tells us that probably k is too small and we have not thought about k yet. Let me see. That is straightforward. The default seems to be 3. And we just can write here k equals 10 maybe to get a smoother picture. That looks better. And now we haven't learned yet how to actually choose k in a systematic way. Let's just try values. 100 is even smoother. The largest possible value would be the length of x, which is 272. Let's just try that. 272. That comes out as a straight line. And that makes sense because if we take the 272 nearest neighbors, that means all points. So there is no dependence on x anymore. That is just the average of the y. So let's try mean y is 70 and a bit. That's where the red line is. If we go down from that a bit, let's do 250, then there is a bit of scope for changing values, but you'll see what happens. Because we are averaging 250 values, it's very easy to be in a situation where that is the leftmost 250 values or the rightmost 250 values as the nearest neighbors. And only if you're very close to the center of the plot, then you get not a straight line, but you actually get a change. We can go down from that. So again, it was 350 values. Say 120 is about a third of it. Then you see what happens. The left-hand third and the right-hand third are flat. That is measured by number of points, not by distance. And the middle third of points has actual change. And then we can go down to 50 or 10 or 5. We have seen 3 or 2 or 1. And the one nearest neighbor estimate is a special case. So one nearest neighbor just means the red curve takes the value of the point nearest to it. And if we look here in the center, the value just above 3, you can see quite clearly what's happening. Namely, the jumps are, of course, in the middle between the points now. So if I go right from this point, then exactly at the midpoint, the red curve will jump up because at the midpoint, it is when it changes that the point to the right is closer rather than the point to the left. And then we average one point, which just means we take the value at the point. So this curve goes through the data points and then jumps always at the middle between points. I'm not quite sure what's going on at the right. I know what's going on the right. We stopped our plot at 5 and the data goes a bit beyond 5. So what we should probably do here is we should do 5.5. Good. Now it goes even through the last points. We are missing one or two here, 3 there. Let us investigate. I suspect maybe duplicate values. Oh, yes. Yeah. There are lots of 4.8s in here. And then it is not quite clear to me what the method is actually meant to do. There is some choice. It either picks one of the corresponding y values or it takes the average of the y values. I don't know what that package does. But whatever, so it's okay if it does not hit this point exactly, but most points are just a single observation for x value and these points. We go exactly through and we jump at the midpoints between observations. Good, so this is what I wanted to tell you about the k-nearest neighbor estimator. And the method so far is quite simple. There is one gap left, namely we have not discussed how to choose k. And that we'll do in the next section where we discuss cross-validation, which is one of the methods you can use to choose k. Okay, so see you in a few days in the next section. Bye-bye.